My name is Chris Lynch. I'm from Carthage College. I'm chairing this panel. In this panel, we move to an aspect of the activities of the Leo Strauss Center that we've talked about a little bit, but now we'll focus on more, and that is the transcript project. All four of these presenters are engaged with the transcripts in different ways. They'll discuss those. I'll introduce each of them very briefly before they speak. And we're going to start with Christopher Nadon, who got his degree at the University of Chicago, Committee on Social Thought, has worked on Xenophon and other things, and is now at Claremont McKenna College.
Thank you. Talk about editing the transcript sounds like the perfect thing to do right after lunch. So it's Nathan Tarkoff who gave the charge for this committee, and he issued a charge to the members of this panel. I believe he requested that we speak, at least in part, of the experience of listening to the tapes of the course, since that's the occasion that we're here formally to celebrate. As editor of the 1963 course on Xenophon, I'm somewhat limited in material to draw upon, as tapes for only four of the 16 sessions are still extant. This means that my experience was relatively brief. I can also say that this part of my job was relatively easy. The original transcriber, if we can assume that the other tapes were treated as well as the four that we have, did an excellent job. We found no large or significant omissions, noted relatively few places where the written record differed from the audio, and corrected a smattering of what seemed to have been typographical errors. And I'd also like to thank at this point Robert Garrow, who's a graduate student at Claremont University, who's helped me with this. He's been quite helpful in getting this part of the work done. Indeed, the final session of the transcript concludes with the words, "explicit feliciter," a traditional tag used by medieval scribes to mark the end of the work. Now, whether that's happily it's over, or it's over and I happily did it, it could perhaps be ambiguous. But it seems like an appropriate tag, as the scribe did his work with religious fidelity. Our task in listening was also pleasant, in the sense that the sound quality of the Xenophon recordings is, unlike many of the others, quite good. It was pleasant in another way as well. There's a warmth and gentleness in Strauss's exchanges with the students, particularly those students who seem to be taking this as their first course with him, which is present but less palpable in the transcription. It's present in the transcription, but it's less palpable than it is in the audio record. As someone who came to know Strauss primarily through his published works and indirectly through classes taken with his students, this gentleness came as something of a surprise. You can hear that kind of, I never heard Strauss laugh like that at any of his students. Yes, I know. I've never heard any stories of Strauss's students calling him the scalpel. Be that as it's may. So this gentleness came, for whatever reasons, this gentleness came of something of a surprise to me, as it no doubt would have been to people such as John Wilde, or the editors of the Arabic text of the Al-Farabi's Philosophy of Plato, whom Strauss takes to task, despite the fact that at the beginning of the paper he thanks someone else for helping him with translations from the Arabic. Or a cast of dozens, if not hundreds, of other scholars who had the happy misfortune of making Strauss's acquaintance, not in person, but in print. But lest I be suspected of hawking the Xenophon audio tape as short, easy, and pleasant, or worse, holding them out as some kind of antidote to other well-known treatments of Xenophon that could perhaps not altogether inaccurately be characterized as long, hard, well, and you get the rest of the story. So let me turn rather to some considerations of the Xenophon course transcript taken as a whole and my experience of reading that. It seems to me there's two general categories of Strauss transcripts that are of particularly interest. First, those devoted to an author or subject that would seem to be of importance for Strauss, yet never given a direct treatment by him in print. Kant would seem to me be perhaps the most outstanding example from this category. and the courses Strauss offered on him in 1958 and 1969 of particular interest. The other category of interesting transcripts would be those devoted to an author Strauss did treat extensively in print, with our interest being heightened if that published treatment appeared to be especially cryptic or enigmatic, the hope being that the course presentation might offer some guidance or help fill in some of the gaps. Now, as luck would have it, the 1963 Xenophon transcript manages to fall into both of these categories. It is devoted to an author Strauss treated in print, but 8 of the 16 sessions are given over to his reading of the one major work by Xenophon that went largely neglected in Strauss's corpus, The Education of Cyrus. This ultimate neglect might have come as something of a surprise to the Strauss of the late 1930s, for the work was clearly on his mind. Indeed, there exists in the Strauss archives a 6 or 7 page fragment, likely dating from the 1930s, or from the late 30s, of the beginning of an essay which would appear to have been intended as an extended treatment of The Education of Cyrus. Let me tentatively suggest that the 1963 transcript, apart from allowing us to see how Strauss interpreted this or that passage of the text, might also help us to account for this neglect, and to do so in a way that humanizes Strauss's intellect, while at the same time perhaps also increases our appreciation for the Herculean labors he was willing to impose upon himself. In one of the sessions on The Education of Cyrus, Strauss says, "For some time, I thought," I never knew Strauss, so I won't do a imitation of him as others have done, but "for some time I thought," and this is perhaps not entirely wrong, "that Xenophon presents here in Cyrus and his circle the barbaric equivalent of Socrates and his circle. Now, if Socrates and his circle were barbarians, they would of course have become conquerors of the world with Socrates in command." Strauss returns to this thesis repeatedly in the transcript, usually in trying to match up various companions of Cyrus to those of Socrates. And there exist extensive notes in the archives dating from various times that seem to show him working on this same problem. I think it's fair to say that in the course, and likely in the notes, although these are difficult to decipher, he never sustained the thesis to his own satisfaction. Even the master bloodhound, to borrow the metaphor Professor Lerner borrowed yesterday from Xenophon, even the master bloodhound, it seems, could occasionally pursue a false scent. Of course, one can only speculate that this false lead or dead end is what kept him from publishing a fuller interpretation, but the effort he shows in pursuing it reminds us of now, if I might shift the metaphor, of just how much heavy rock and raw ore he was willing to dig up and refine in order to unearth and recover the genuine insights that he did. Even without an extended analysis of The Education of Cyrus, Strauss nevertheless managed to still spill more ink on Xenophon than on any other author. 3 monographs and several articles, the earliest of which, The Spirit of Sparta, or The Taste of Xenophon, might well represent Strauss's coming out in 1939 as a Straussian. And if we were to take Strauss at his word in a letter to Scholem from 1972, the 2 books on Xenophon Socrates were, as Strauss wrote, "not the last thing I have written, but I believe they are the best." Xenophon would seem to have then remained in 1972 for Strauss what he was in a letter to Klein dating from the 1930s, his special darling. But if these late works are Strauss's best books and deal with the subject of his special darling, this by no means entails their being his clearest or most accessible books. As Strauss tersely notes in the preface to Xenophon's Socrates, he could here, without impropriety, have been more prolix. The classroom, however, can compel even the most reticent to a certain greater prolixity, and this happily and helpfully seems to have been the case with Strauss, at least in part. Let me give here 2 small examples where the course transcript casts some light on the written presentation. In chapter 14 of book 3 of the Memorabilia, Xenophon relates a speech Socrates makes criticizing a glutton for eating only meat without the bread. In Xenophon's Socrates, Strauss offers the following gloss. "The occasion was that one of those present ate the meat itself by itself, i.e., without the bread. In accordance with this last speech of the book, the last speech of the book deals with Socrates' interpretation of a term used in the tongue of the Athenians." Yes. I'm not making this up. Very helpful. Perhaps for some. Here's Strauss speaking in class on the same passage. Now, here comes the greatest beauty, which cannot well be brought out in the translation. The beginning of paragraph 2. This fellow was eating the meat, itself by itself, which is the favorite Platonic expression for the ideas. He ate, as it were, the idea in its purity. You see, that is a xenophontic joke, which of course presupposes, for no one would make it who didn't know these things and understand them intimately. So I thought this would be perhaps be of some help for understanding of Xenophon's way of speaking about philosophy. One cannot understand Xenophon if one doesn't think about the philosophic manners. But he writes in a way that you can completely miss it. Indeed. Xenophon seems not to have been alone in writing in this way. Or perhaps I find myself alone in feeling some gratitude, not unmixed, of course, no doubt intentionally inflicted by Strauss, with some shame at the necessity for needing it. But I was also grateful, as I said, that Strauss was willing, at least this once in class, to stoop to what he elsewhere called the loathsome business of explaining a joke, which he apparently wasn't willing to do in print. The second passage from Xenophon's Socrates that I'd like to compare to the class transcript concerns the peculiar definitions given in the memorabilia of envy and leisure. In the book, Strauss highlights the peculiarities of the definitions by showing that they couldn't apply to a reasonable man. He concludes the page or so of analysis with the following sentence. The foregoing interpretations are not incompatible with an alternative interpretation, according to which one would have to refer the two definitions to the gods. Are the gods envious? Do the gods have leisure? Yes. That would have been an interesting alternative interpretation. Let's hear some more. But to find Strauss's extensive elaboration, one must turn to the transcript, where this not incompatible alternative interpretation is fleshed out over several pages and given an authoritative stamp. Here's how he concludes it. So, the gods like the man who acts well. The gods like him. But what does this imply? They're not envious of his felicity. The view that the gods are envious of the happy man, the man of felicity, amounts to the absurdity that the gods are envious of their friends. And now you understand the definition of envy. When he spoke of envy as dissatisfaction, displeasure at the well-being of one's friends, he had in mind the great question of the envy of the gods. This, I believe, is the only explanation. So what Strauss apparently took to be the only explanation turns in print into an allusion to an unelaborated alternative appended to an extended but necessarily defective interpretation. Charming. It actually becomes charming after a while. Now, to heighten your interest in this transcript is giving us an unbuttoned and unrestrained Strauss spilling the beans on his favorite author. I'll continue in this vein by quoting my favorite passage from the transcript. Or to use a phrase one often finds in Strauss's mouth in the transcripts, here's a beauty. In a memorable passage from his restatement on Xenophon's Hiero, Strauss claims, those with a natural preference for Jane Austen rather than Dostoevsky might have an easier access to the quiet charms of Xenophon. He makes a similar kind of argument in the course transcript. However, there the author, whom he compares disfavorably to Xenophon, is not Dostoevsky. Strauss notes that whereas Xenophon's noble simplicity and quiet grandeur is particularly alien to modern tastes, Plato's divine madness plus dialectics finds an immediate response. Hence, Xenophon's greater utility for helping us to better understand ourselves as children of the 20th century, since he gives us greater distance. Strauss goes even further when later in that session he's comparing Xenophon and Plato's apologies with Diogenes Laertius's account. He says the following. Now, if you compare these three versions, the authentic version, Plato's version, and Xenophon's version, you see that Plato takes much greater liberties with the text of the indictment than Xenophon does. Xenophon takes a very small liberty. That reveals the character of the writings of the two men. Plato is, in a crude way, crudely spoken, infinitely more obvious than Xenophon is. Infinitely. He continues, I have myself gone through a time after Xenophon's way of writing dawned upon me, where for quite some time I couldn't stand Plato anymore. Because that was too loud compared with the still voice of Xenophon, who speaks like a man of the people to men of the people. Only those who listen will hear something of a higher order. This calls to mind the conclusion of liberalism and responsibility, where Strauss reminds us that, quote, liberal education consists in learning to listen to still and small voices, and therefore becoming deaf to loud speakers. Who would have thought that loud speaker was Plato? This seems to me to bespeak an exquisite sensibility and refinement of taste that mark quite a distance from one that claimed to have once been dominated and charmed by Nietzsche. But now I'm afraid it's time to sober up and come clean. One can learn much from the Xenophon transcript, as I hope I've shown briefly, but I believe it contains no secret teaching, no Rosetta Stone, no solution to the riddle of being, much less any solution to the riddle of a sphinx. In fact, I think the Strauss contained in the transcript is likely more reticent and therefore less helpful than the one contained in his books. There are several considerations that lean in this direction. But once, just this once, and only on this occasion, and only before this assemblage, I'd like to rest my case on an argument from silence. I think no one who studied and puzzled over Xenophon's memorabilia can fail to be disappointed when they turn to the class transcript with Strauss's selection of the passages assigned for class. You can't be but disappointed when you see the passages that he actually assigns for class. He skips over all the interesting stuff for the most part. And here he is, giving a rather tepid justification for his choice. What we're doing today is, of course, indefensible, because we're merely taking out a kind of snippets from the memorabilia. But since we must have an inkling of the memorabilia when we want to understand Xenophon, we choose, reasonably, what at first glance is the most theoretical part of the memorabilia, which is the definitions. Now let us turn then to chapter 9 of the third book. Perhaps it's just my imagination, but I wonder if there's not a hint of bashfulness in having offered such a flimsy justification for his choice. And there's an almost lawyerly care in the way that Strauss phrases his justification for this choice. We choose reasonably what at first glance is the most theoretical part, the definitions. Plausible, perhaps, but worse, it's actually inaccurate for what he actually did. Strauss actually assigned the chapter before the definitions as well. And he didn't begin this assignment on the of the class, just after having said this, on the chapter of the definitions, but rather the one preceding it that shows Socrates in conversation with Aristippus. And the session opens with a rather lengthy discussion of it. This only seems to highlight Strauss's unwillingness to discuss the chapters leading up to it. What then exactly is it in those? What is exactly in those first seven chapters of Book 3 that Strauss is so eager to neglect? He'd noted in the introductory lecture from the class before that in that Book 3, chapters 1 through 7 of the memorabilia made up a distinct grouping of chapters. And in this lecture, he gives a brief sketch of their subject matter in order to set up the context of the remaining parts they do discuss. But he gives the students no inkling whatsoever of their actual contents. This must have required, on Strauss's part, a considerable act of self-control. I say this because the memorabilia consists, as I'm sure you all well know, of 39 chapters. The central chapter of the work, therefore, turns out to be Book 3, Chapter 3. Which also turns out to be the central chapter of the section of chapters Strauss singles out but fails to discuss. Further, the first chapter of this section contains an explicit discussion of why a knowing general places his weakest or most vulnerable troops in the middle of a formation. What more could a good Straussian want? But apparently Leo Strauss did not always adhere to the tenets of his school. And I think here the reason is not too difficult to discern. Those missing chapters contain, I believe, the core or the foundation of Xenophon's Socrates' critique of conventional moral virtue, while at the same time his demonstration of the political necessity of such virtue. And this theme Strauss apparently did not want to address in class. As I mentioned at the beginning of these remarks, there's a gentleness or warmth to Strauss's classroom presence that will no means absent is certainly less prominent in his writings. Now, all this probably amounts to nothing other or nothing more than to say that Strauss practiced what he preached. He adapted his presentation to his audience. But is this not the same Leo Strauss who, when pressed to discuss how one should teach political theory in college, replied, quote, "Always assume there's one silent student in your class who is by far superior to you in head and in heart. Would such a character not deserve greater frankness?" Several considerations cut against this objection, I think. First, Strauss designates it as his advice on how to teach as a rule of thumb or a general rule. And if there's one thing I think I've learned from Strauss, it's that one ought not to put too much faith in general formulations. Second, it's important to recall the gloss Strauss himself put on this advice. "I meant by this, do not have too high an opinion of your importance and have the highest opinion of your duty, your responsibility." This seems to me to speak for itself. But if combined with the general rule against rules, it might also point to a third reason Strauss taught and wrote as he did. Duty depends upon varying circumstances and our concrete assessment of them. As nice and as modest as it sounds to always assume there's a silent student in the room superior to you in head and heart, it smacks of something of the noble or well-born lie, which inasmuch as it's well-born is welcome, but inasmuch as it's a lie should be kept from entering our own hearts and minds. At the risk of offending some present here today, I dare say Strauss never directly experienced such a situation himself in the classroom. And it would have been foolish for him to act as if he did. But as for the eventual audience of his books, the classroom taken in a much wider sense, including perhaps even someone from Burma, 2,200, as he's once remarked, there, Strauss's assumption seems to me much better warranted. Thus, as helpful as the course transcript may be concerning this or that detail of a particular text, I think it's to Strauss's published works that we ought quickly to return. Thank you.
Hobbes is the subject of the transcript that our next speaker has been working on, Steve Lenzner, who got his PhD at Harvard University in government. And is an accomplished interpreter of Strauss's published works, will address us on Hobbes.
Thank you. I had the unfortunate experience of losing my computer or leaving my computer at an airport on Thursday, which I only realized when I tried to get aboard my plane on Friday, and my computer was not at the airport security line, and trying to determine whose fault this is, whether it's part of my adversarial relationship with God, the fault of the security guard who did not try to stop as I was sprinting for the plane as the doors were, but it's somebody's fault, not mine. And so therefore, anything right amiss or less perfect than you would have expected from me, make the proper allowances and adjust your memories. The best parts of the remarks are not written out. But my characteristically subdued title is "On the Use and Disadvantage of the Transcripts for the Study of Strauss." When Nathan asked me if I would be interested in editing a transcript, I said I'd be honored and naturally asked him what courses were available. since I had studied with some care Strauss's two mature essays on Hobbes, as well as own both versions of the Leviathan, paperback and hardcover. I asked for it. And I repeat, I asked for it. But it seemed to me merely a happy coincidence that it was much the shortest. After the Herculean editorial labors of a young friend of mine named Neil Rogoshevsky, currently pursuing a PhD at Cambridge, the transcript now stands almost twice as long, jumping from, so we can at least get some numbers here, its original 87,000 words to its current 169,000. I'm reasonably sure that he will not be displeased that when he learns his contributions were gratefully acknowledged before such a select audience. As means of entering into my chosen topic, let me quote two passages from Werner Daunhauser's 1975, Leo Strauss, Becoming Naive Again, an essay that paints a beautiful and vivid portrait of the experience of having one's eyes and mind opened by Strauss. I'm particularly pleased to be able to cite this wonderful tribute to a teacher at this conference, as it provides me with the opportunity to express publicly my deep gratitude and affection for the author of that tribute, whom I know as both teacher and friend, and even more, as of a week ago, my official Facebook friend. I'm sure I'm not the only one who regrets that Werner is not here with us today. Having just arrived as a first-year graduate student at the U of C in fall 1956, the young Daunhauser enters into Strauss's 1956 seminar in Hobbes, which is essentially the same as the seminar I edited, so just consider the two interchangeable, and these my remarks on the 64 transcript. Not the least remarkable of a number of remarkable suggestions or commands which Leo Strauss produced that day was that we simply must begin with the assumption that Hobbes's teaching was true, not relatively true, not true for Hobbes, not true for its time, but simply true. That was why we had to read him with all the care we could muster, and that was why I was to hear him say this again and again. One ought not even to begin to criticize an author before one had done all one could do to understand him correctly, to understand him as he understood himself. What is more, we were there not only to learn about Hobbes, but to learn from him. At the risk of making Strauss's temper, the first mention in Professor Faulkner's remarks, which in turn sparked Nathan's fond memories of his own chastisement by Strauss, I will quote the second passage from the Daunhauser memoir. His good humor was almost unfailing. Only once in the years I studied with him did I see him abandon that sunniness. And it was during that very seminar in Hobbes, when the questioner accused him of not taking Hobbes seriously enough. He icily informed the student that he had spent more time studying Hobbes than had anyone he knew. Urbane and polite, he deplored rudeness, but loved to be challenged, and his response was almost unfailingly witty. I found it very striking, and it will play into my remarks later on that the one student who sparked Strauss's anger was perhaps it was a remark concerning Hobbes, of whom who's probably the great thinker that Strauss treats most dismissively and most disdainfully in some of his published works, especially Natural Right and History. But that raised the problem for me. But the spirit of open-mindedness conveyed by these two passages about the 1956 seminars is just as pervasive in the 1964 seminar. A Strauss who subordinates himself not only in what he said, but in how he taught, to the great thinkers to whom his classes are devoted. And so I find that there are three legitimate uses or three ways in which the transcripts properly employed can be of help in understanding Strauss. Though I also would like to stress that these are emphatically auxiliary. By no means are the transcripts necessary or anything we learn from the transcripts necessary to form an adequate understanding of Strauss's thought. Strauss provided in his books, his published mature books, to announce my conclusion, all the materials that one needs to determine his serious thought and intention. Number one, the transcripts thus show Strauss's open-mindedness and generosity. They show that he practiced not what he preached, but what he professed. Just getting back at Chris for making me follow him. They are models of the sort of interpretation that precede critique, to employ a distinction Strauss elaborates at the outset of Persecution, the Art of Writing's concluding chapter. If one reads them, if one sees the manner in which Strauss proceeds, I mean, making the genuine attempt always to give whatever thinker he's teaching the benefit of the doubt, if he seems to fall into an error, try to figure out why would somebody with such a high IQ make such a mistake. I think it would be very helpful for the character of the Strauss scholarship, which to me seems to have the quality frequently of which side was Strauss on? Or subject to some sort of widespread belief that he was a narrow partisan of some sort, be it of the ancients, Machiavelli, Nietzsche, Jerusalem, Athens, the greatness of American liberal democracy, or the evil mastermind of American hegemony intent on hoodwinking the vulgar for reasons that have yet to be identified. I think I recently read somewhere that Strauss was the hidden mastermind behind the NRA. All of these are unprofitable attempts because they try to place Strauss on a side. What was his position, as opposed to asking what he thought, how he thought about it. If he was a partisan of anything, he was a partisan of human excellence at its peaks. So the transcripts can help us appreciate that. The transcripts can facilitate understanding of any number of texts and thinkers that Strauss treats in his writings. Such knowledge can prove of great, even indispensable benefit when attempting to understand the most difficult of Strauss's writings, or at least so I've been told. In any event, I do not see how such knowledge would prove an impediment to understanding him. Yeah, that was not a bad joke and not a single laugh. That's depressing. The third way transcripts can help is that they can serve as controls allowing one to identify where, if not why, Strauss offers incomplete and even on occasion positively misleading interpretations of the works and thinkers he studied. So in all those ways, the transcripts are useful. And then, of course, the character of my remarks not be misunderstood. I'm speaking simply with regard to what they can teach us about Strauss, the transcripts. And Nathan's and Jenny's decision to make them public are, you know, right, a wonderful treasure trove for students of political thought. But in one instance alone, that of Strauss, they seem to me problematic or subject to abuse as people look to discover what he said in private under the mistaken assumption that something he said, which may or may not have lasted beyond was it eight tracks, whatever they were, reel by reel, as opposed to these books he labored over for decades. In any event, the Strauss of the transcripts is emphatically the scholar he professes to be in his published writings, which means that he takes on that, he becomes that person, but he is not that person when he claims to be that person in his books. He points unhesitatingly away from himself in the because he properly understands that his role is to be a facilitator of study, but not the object thereof. He is not a philosopher. And I understand that that's a sort of common debate amongst the students here, scholar, philosopher, as if they're mutually exclusive categories. So we have to turn to the books. And since we are concerned with Strauss's Hobbes, to his most famous statement on that thinker, to borrow a phrase of Professor Myers, after Strauss became Strauss. So turning to natural right and history. But once we begin to inhabit that world, we soon recognize that it's almost 180 degrees away from that which we came. For a natural right in history, the self-identified scholar who bristled with anger at the suggestion that he hadn't done Hobbes justice does far worse than failing to do him justice or taking him seriously, or so it would seem. He presents a picture of a confused, willful, and flighty Hobbes who jumps from intellectual desire to intellectual desire and initiates a process that seetheth only in Heideggerian oblivion of eternity. In natural right and history, Hobbes is the whipping boy for Strauss, the demon whose thoughts set in motion a series of thoughts and actions that ineluctably led to the morass of historicism and relativism in which we currently flounder. So far from trying to understand Hobbes as he understands himself, or even enjoining us to understand Hobbes as he understands himself, Strauss devotes the first part of his essay to setting before our eyes a series of ill-conceived philosophic syntheses, political idealism and hedonism, Platonic physics and Epicurean physics, adamantine dogmatism founded upon extreme skepticism, all for different ends, whether it's to secure knowledge, promote the political good, but in so doing, the vainglorious Hobbes shows himself, or Strauss's vainglorious Hobbes is shown to be enslaved to the very tradition upon which he did little but heap contempt. This presents a problem. If my account, which of course is accurate, or only slightly exaggerated, which is, I believe it is, both slightly exaggerated and only slightly exaggerated. I mean, how do we account for this? I mean, I've had that experience frequently of reading that chapter, and here, unfortunately, when I was about to get to the good stuff, my remarks end. I was just reading it and feeling no attraction whatsoever for Hobbes. But he manifestly had the skills, gifts, abilities to have written in an entirely different way to make Hobbes remarkably attractive and charming, and doubtless to turn us all into good Hobbesians. I guess one thing I noticed along these lines, which I had not sufficiently appreciated before. I only began to appreciate it when I raised the question, why did he spend, given that treatment, and also given the somewhat dismissive or not anywhere near it's equally dismissive, but still the somewhat dismissive treatment you get in, on the basis of Hobbes's political philosophy. I mean, Hobbes must have been one of the five thinkers, certainly, whom he wrote and studied most. And so was it that he just devoted whatever percentage of his life to studying somebody who does not deserve to be in the company of a Machiavelli, Maimonides, Plato? At that point, I remember there was one passage of Strauss's that painted a very different portrait of Strauss, of Hobbes. And that happens to be in the one paragraph introduction to chapter 5 of Natural Right and History, which is the structure of the book is very odd. There are 6 chapters, but between those 6 chapters, they have 9 separate sections, because the chapter 6 is on Rousseau and Burke. Chapter 5 has this one paragraph introduction, A. Hobbes, which is also sort of subdivided because there's a just unexplained break of half dozen lines before he starts a new section beginning with Machiavelli, but 2 formal sections, one on Hobbes, one on Locke, and then the first 4 chapters. So this one paragraph introduction, which based on the prior general rules I had observed in reading Strauss, made me think it was not fundamental, turns out to be, as far as I can tell, fundamental. And he gives an account of Hobbes here, which is, I think, his most, it's among his most memorable shorthand thumbnail sketches of a thinker. It's not altogether uncritical, but on the whole, it's praise, and you could see, I mean, it has a genuine quality of attraction and amusement. And let me just read it. Thomas Hobbes, that imprudent, impish, an iconoclastic extremist, that first plebeian philosopher who is so enjoyable a writer because of his almost boyish straightforwardness, his never-failing humanity, that's exceedingly high praise, and his marvelous clarity and force. Now, given that that was what was in Strauss's mind, apparently, as he undertook to write the essay, why did he not write an essay that showed these qualities? So I guess to be less coy about it, my suspicion is that this is the one time in Strauss's writing where everything that follows has to be understood in light of the first word, instead of the first word such or understanding the opening in light of what comes after it, or being willing to revise your apparent indignation with Machiavelli's teaching of evil. Instead, you have to always keep in mind that this is for Strauss, or at least I believe it is for Strauss, both opening as well as central statement, what he genuinely thought of Hobbes, and read what follows accordingly, or read it skeptically. With regard to explaining his procedure in Natural Right and History, I only discovered or started putting these things together on Thursday, and so I don't have my typical brilliant polished interpretation, be it due to God or the security guard or Chris or there's another passage which it seems to me could help shed light. This is from a review on Carl Loewith's book on Hegel and Nietzsche. He talks about the book's treatment as narrative and meditative rather than disputative or analytical. At times, for instance, when describing Goethe's Christian paganism and Hegel's philosophic Christianism, the author adapting himself to the character of his subject seems to draw rather than to speak. Am I running out of time? I'll wrap it up by saying that this is what Strauss does. Natural and History is perhaps his most narrative book. There's a tendency in all of his writings, but it occurs more in things which he's more manifestly rhetorical, to take on the character of whom he's writing about, to write about Machiavelli in a Machiavellian, shocking, overstating manner. And here I think he is doing that with regard to Hobbes. He's treating Hobbes as Hobbes may have treated Hobbes if he had been upset with himself, or say as Hobbes treated Aristotle. And it's, I believe, by things like that, following out footnotes and various other writing devices, all of which Strauss points you to, that one could discern his true view of Hobbes, his true critique of Hobbes, as well as his genuine appreciation for him.
Before introducing our next speaker, could I just get briefly clarification, Steve, on this? Is a main thrust of the potential problem with the transcripts, in your view, that the scholar Strauss that he enacts in class and that he presents in a way in his readings could, in his published writings, could eclipse Strauss the philosopher that he presents in all of its fullness in his readings?
Yeah, I don't think that that's a real risk. I mean, I called attention to that because it seems to me that's the sort of thing which would not be fully appreciated, that people do not raise the question, is he being open-minded here, fair here? They tend to take things at face value. I mean, what worries me is that for whatever reason, scholars have this tendency, especially with Strauss, to prefer the unpublished to the published. Yeah. Think that all the hidden they're going to find all sorts of secrets which he won't confess in public, be it in letters, be it in unpublished writings, what have you.
Okay. Or, yeah. Thanks. Our next speaker has been working in a way that the other folks working on transcripts have not, on a transcript on Montesquieu, because he's been translating that into French, and it is Olivier Sedeyn. Among his many impressive degrees, he holds one from the University of Paris. He has the rare distinction of being certified to teach political philosophy in France, and he has established something called the Institut, Eleuthère, where he teaches singing, yoga, Plato, Aristotle, and Leo Strauss.
Trying.
Yes. Olivier.
Thank you. Yes, I'm here as a translator. Well, I translated many, many books from Strauss. I want first to thank Professor Nathan Tucker for inviting me to speech and for all the work he does here. And I am going to give my testimony of the effect the teaching of Strauss had on myself since now 30 years. In a giving of accounts, Jakob Klein says, what preoccupied me mostly during those years was this. Whatever thought I might have and whatever interest I might have in anything seemed to me to be located completely within me, so that I could not really understand anything outside me, could not understand anything uttered or written by another man, another person. When I wrote those lines, I thought that I was myself in that same state when I began to study. I have been a student in philosophy in the years 17, And I've been in the ENS, no, École Normale Supérieure, and I was after appointed as a teacher of philosophy in Normandy to students about 17 to about 21 years old. And at that time, beginnings of my 30s, in the first years of the 80s of the last century, I was a student at the Claude Lefort Seminar at the École des Hautes Études en Sciences Sociales, School of High Schools, of High Studies in Social Sciences. And Claude Lefort spoke often of Strauss. And I was at that time very interested in ancient philosophy. And so I began to read, first in French. There were two books translated at that time, Natural Right and History and On Tyranny. And then I bought his other books in English. And I realized very soon that there was in those books a very, very important thing, very important thought. And at the same time, I realized that I could not understand them. So I began to translate just to understand. And the fact is that the experience of translation is very interesting. I take it now as a fundamentally the same as reading. And when you are supposed to teach philosophy, you have to study the great philosophers, read them in class and explain them, at least what you understand, and often realize that you do not understand. And translating is like to go across a river. On one shore, you're in the original language, and on the other, you're in your own language. And you have to pass from one shore to the other many times, constantly. And you have to learn the original language always more. And you have to learn always more your own language. But to know better the languages is only one thing. To understand the thought is another. So it would be better to say that on one shore you're reading the words, and from that shore you embark on an unknown sea for a trip in which you do not know where you go and what you will find. And as Strauss says, with approximately the same metaphor, surely you will not be the same man when you return. So my starting point was my inability to understand, combined with the feeling that I was hearing the ring of truth when I read. And I translated first The City and Man, which is an extraordinary book, surely one of the greatest of Strauss' book. And my difficulties were great, but I learned. Translating was a kind of listening to the writer, and in that sense, the writing of Strauss was for me a teaching, and he was a teacher. I realize how different is my situation from the one of so many students of Strauss here. But in fact, it was for me a very, very big teacher. During about 20 years, I translated The City and Man, Persecution and the Art of Writing, Liberalism, Ancient and Modern, Argument and Action in Plato's Laws, What's Political Philosophy, Xenophon's Socratic Discourse, Xenophon's Socrates, Studies in Platonic Political Philosophy, Socrates and Aristophanes, The History of Political Philosophy, On German Nihilism, also a collection of essays on reason and revelation under the title of Why We Remain Jews, On the Symposium, the correspondence of Strauss with Scholem, and a collection of essays on history under the title of Political History and Political Philosophy in History. All those translations were published, but I also translated for myself natural right and history on tyranny, philosophy on gazettes, and a great part of thoughts on Machiavelli, and a number of essays published and unpublished. And now I discover and read the transcripts of the score of the courses. I have worked on his courses on Plato's Gorgias, on Montesquieu, and also I'm interested in the courses about history. So it's clear I've translated a very big part of what Strauss published, and also a part of what he did not publish. And I have also translated some other writers, because it was just a way of things. I translated Michael Oakeshott, two books of him, and also the Aristotle's Jaeger. I was interested about the question of evolution, and a little book of Nietzsche on Plato. So, as you can realize, translating has become for me a way of reading and maybe a way of life. And so I have been with Strauss a big part of my life. Really, it is always with me. And in fact, I learned many things, and I have to explain a little what I think I have learned. Strauss's books, as you know, are commentaries, very close to the text. So to understand his readings of Plato, Aristotle, or others, I had to read them, and I had to have them always at hand. And his readings of them are always very original, very incisive, full of spirit and vision. He gave me a clear view of the history of political philosophy and even of the history of Western civilization. And with him, I think I learned how to read. So I learned many things with him, not only with him, but with him, many writers that I did not know first, and that is, if I can say, contents, as it were, as there is a table of contents in a book. And that is naturally very substantial and very substantial learning. But I think, above all, that I learn something other, something difficult to express, but which is maybe, let's dare to say, the truth, the ultimate truth. That does not seem so substantial as the contents are, evidently. But in fact, maybe it is more. I know that can seem a little mad, but maybe it is not so unsound as it seems. It's not very easy to explain, but I think that I'm not alone to have this experience. Most of the time, Strauss comments a writer. He follows his thoughts, repeats them, sometimes exactly, sometimes slightly differently, and he adds something, sometimes some powerful insights. I think a good book to write would be entitled Strauss, the Reader. And maybe we would find the best material in his remarks on how to read Maimonides, Halevi, Spinoza, Plato, which are very substantive and stimulating. The main characteristic is, I think, to be sensitive to the text we read, to be humble, and that means to accept what the author says as maybe the truth, even and above all, when that is not my own first opinion, and also to develop attention, mindfulness, alertness, and last but not least, you must do yourself the work of thinking the problem that the writer has thought and examine whether he's right or not. And part of my time, I am a yoga instructor. And well, that's my idiosyncrasy. And it may seem strange to make such a comparison, but I think it can be relevant to get the idea. What is important above all in yoga is attention, listening to your body, to be aware of your sensations, to develop attention, concentration, mindfulness, and not thinking. And so you discover parts of your body that you did not really sense before. New sensations. And you have also an experience very close to the one you have when you feel that you go deeper and deeper when you understand, you begin to understand a book. And you know, it is very similar to the trip of which I spoke before, in which you don't know where you go, but you go there. In that sense, I could say Strauss is a wonderful instructor of the yoga of reading. It happens that people charge Strauss of asking us to submit ourselves completely to the writer, to forget to be critical. And that so-called critical attitude is precisely forgetting to be critical, because the first target of your critic must be yourself, your opinions, your beliefs, to realize that there are inside yourself your things that are obstacles to your understanding. And then dropping progressively everything which is in you, you're empty. Only the conscience of your ignorance remain. And you can let the author thought, or better said, the author's action of writing, to penetrate into your own thought. You let it work and operate and act inside yourself, and that allows you to open yourself to another way of thinking and to open yourself simply and not to have any more any belief. Everybody is not immediately ready for that. To give an illustration, let me tell you a story coming from Sufi. The story reads like that. There was a man who wanted to learn. He goes to a master, a wise man, and asks him, I wish to learn. Will you teach me? The master answered, I do not feel that you can learn. So the man said, can you teach me how to learn? And the master answered, can you learn how to let me teach? And I think that story shows the difficulty. The difficulty is entirely on the student's side. It is the student who has to learn, and he must change to be able to learn. It is possible to learn, but maybe it is not possible to speak the truth. The truth cannot be said, but it can be learned. Maybe it is not possible to teach the truth, but surely it can be learned, because there are, at least there have been, wise people. But the student or the disciple must have some requirements. Strauss says something like that in the following passage of The City and Man, in the chapter of Thucydides. I quote all the paragraph to expose you to Strauss' thought, and also to give you the pleasure of hearing him, to have again a taste of his writing. It is in the ninth section entitled The Questionable Universalism of the City, and the passage of which Richard Zinman quoted is, well, one of them is in that paragraph. If the city cannot be understood except in the light of the universalism peculiar to it, toward which it tends, and if that universalism in its turn, by its essential defect, points to the universalism of thought, we understand why Tychodides could present his whole wisdom in the form of a narrative interspersed with speeches, which is severely limited to things political, which is severely political, which is silent about what is at present called Athenian culture. For many of our contemporaries, that silence is not qualified, as it should be, by what he says and indicates about his work, his logos, for they understand the remarks in question as methodological. Yet, he does not only speak, however laconically, about his work and thought. As we have tried to show, he presents his thought, even his education, and therewith Athenian culture. Through his work, he makes us, in the light of the interplay of motion and rest, understand war and peace, barbarism and Greekness, Sparta and Athens. He enables us to understand, as far as in him lies, the nature of human life, or to become wise. But one cannot become wise through understanding Tychodides' thought without realizing at the same time that it is through understanding Tychodides' thoughts that one is becoming wise. For wisdom is inseparable from self-knowledge. We know from Tychodides himself that he was an Athenian. Through understanding him, we see that his wisdom was made possible by the sun and by Athens, by her power and wealth, by her defective polity, by her spirit of daring innovation, by her active doubt of the divine law. By understanding his work, one sees with one's own eyes that Athens was, in a sense, the home of wisdom. Only through becoming wise oneself can one recognize wisdom in others. Wisdom cannot be presented as a spectacle in a way in which battles and the like can be presented. Wisdom cannot be said. It can only be done. Only through understanding Tychodides' work can one see that Athens was, in a sense, the school of Hellas. From Pericles' mouth, we merely hear it asserted. Wisdom cannot be presented by being spoken about. An indirect proof of this is the insipid and at best shallow character of the chapters on the intellectual life of this period, or that which form part of otherwise good modern histories. End of quotes. Well, wisdom cannot be said, it can only be done. Strauss shows, in all his commentaries of Tychodides, how Tychodides does wisdom, how he makes us, through his work, understand, as far as in him lies, the nature of human life, and understanding the nature of human life, as far as in us lies, we become wise ourselves. And Strauss himself does wisdom, for to make us understand the work of Thucydides, he has himself to do it, and not only to speak of it. It is interesting in that sense to wonder if Strauss speaks at all, at any time, if he is not always a doer of wisdom, as paradoxical as it may seem, considering the fact that he wrote and published more than 15 books and that he taught many years. And my answer would be that most of the time he does not speak. He is silent, but he works. He does, including with words, but that is never speaking. He is making us understand, he is opening us as far as in him lies, as far as in us lies, and he does wisdom. If it is so, we can realize the great ambition, the madness, the mania of Strauss, and in a qualified sense, is hubris from the point of view of modern philosophy. He undertook the search for wisdom, and he knows wisdom. He has attained human wisdom, as Socrates did, and he wishes to transmit it as possible, as far as in him lies. But knowing wisdom does not allow you to say it, to speak it, because it is maybe not possible to say it. It is not possible to speak it, because wisdom is never ready-made. And once you have known wisdom, you are compelled to live it and to do it again and again. And where does that wisdom come from? In the tradition of India, in the Upanishads, the writer always says that he is not the author of the truth that he transmits, that truth comes from ancient, very ancient sages of the remote past. In the same manner, in a sense, in his own way, Strauss never pretends to be a sage. Strauss never speaks, or very rarely, of himself, and surely never of himself as a wise man. He does not even speak of him as a philosopher, as a lover of wisdom, but as a lover of the love of wisdom. But that does not mean that he is not really a wise man, and that truth is always, at the same time, new and very, very ancient. But we have to let aside all our opinions to be entirely open to have a chance to get it. So nowadays, do we think of wisdom? Ordinarily, we suppose wisdom is an illusion of the past. Surely, to speak of wisdom, even of Thucydides' wisdom, as Strauss does in his apparently modest way, is something which makes of him a strange teacher in the academic world. The only thing I can say is that I've been very lucky to know him, so I express here my gratitude. Well, I now speak a little about the situation of Strauss in France. I begin, my first translation was made in the 1987, so, but there were others before, but now most of the works of Strauss are available in French. And some have been printed twice or thrice. City in Man and Persecution of the Art of Writing have been printed thrice, and What is Political Philosophy and The History of Political Philosophy have been printed twice. But as you can imagine, they are not bestsellers. And considering the situation in the political science departments, few people know Strauss and read him, really, because the positivism of Bourdieu, if you know him, keeps all kind of political philosophy out of political science faculties. But there are some, of course, who read him. He is read above all by philosophers. But in philosophy department, there are other problems. And many of the few who look at him with interest are from phenomenological, Heideggerian, and theological quarters. And if they have interest in him, they are also very much troubled by his expressions of doubt about revelation. And they take Strauss's positions to be dogmatic ones. And that is, I think, a caricature of his thought. So, having caricatured his thought like that, they say they do not agree with him. And my opinion on that point is that they just have neglected the most important side of Strauss, which is the openness of mind. He never despises morality. He never despises revelation. But he is not a believer. And it seems to me that it is just as if they wanted to save their creed, whether they are new believers or not. So there is a misunderstanding concerning theology, and there is a misunderstanding about what Strauss's work is about. And in my opinion, it is a misunderstanding concerning philosophy itself. And of course, it's a pity, but it's also very common. But the books are available, so every French reader can find Strauss's books. And I think these works do their job slowly. I think that with the time, philosophers will realize that Strauss is a great lover of the love of wisdom, and he will have the place he deserves. Well, these difficulties, combined with the crisis of the university, which is the crisis of Western education, and in that crisis it is very difficult, and as you all know, to teach things so gratuitous as philosophy, and in general humanity in France as elsewhere. Well, that's about the situation in France. Well, I can say a few words again, if I can, I would like to add a few words now about the work of editing and translating the courses on Montesquieu. First, on the work itself.
Mr. Sedeyn, and about how long will that be? Because I want to make sure that Professor Zuckert
gets comments. I can stop.
Oh, okay, maybe we'll move to that. Thank you. Catherine Zuckert of the University of Notre Dame has published many works studying political philosophy. She has had the benefit of taking classes from Strauss in the late 60s and is working on a transcript from 1965 on the Introduction to Political Philosophy.
Excuse me, but I think I will speak more clearly if I stand like Ted. It is perhaps appropriate that I speak last at this conference, although not to have the last word, because I appear here in a double capacity. On the one hand, I was a graduate student at the University of Chicago during the same years as Abe Schulsky, 1964 to 1968. And I took or sat in on almost as many courses given by Leo Strauss as he did. On the other hand, I am also speaking as the editor of one of the transcripts of the courses that has been partially remastered on, has been partially corrected on the basis of the remastered tapes. And I will therefore speak about my experiences first as a student in Strauss's courses, and second with the remastered tapes and transcripts of the course. In my case, the two experiences coincide to a certain extent because that I am editing the transcript of a course that I took. Like Robert Faulkner, I have come to distrust my memory of courses I took more than 40 years ago. That's one of the reasons why the publication of the transcripts will be so useful, I think. Memories fade. In fact, I found many years later, at the time I thought I would remember all the courses. So I didn't even buy the transcripts. In fact, I haven't remembered them. Like Abe, I remembered the course we took in winter term 65 as having been about Aristotle. And that is the way it's listed as being mostly about Aristotle in the list of courses George Anastopoulos composed of the courses Strauss taught at the University of Chicago. In fact, not even half of the lectures are about Aristotle per se. Strauss's idea of a survey course, this was called the Introduction to Political Philosophy, was to begin with the contemporary crisis, respond to a series of 20th and 19th century thinkers, to move back through the history of modern philosophy, and then to begin the study of classical political philosophy with Aristotle's Politics. But I'll talk a bit more about the course later. What I had remembered, and could document if need be, was that both my husband and Michael were, were foolish enough not to take the seminar Strauss offered our first term on a political theorist we used to dismiss at the time as the ferocious Grotius. We have both had reason to rue that decision, since I've had occasion to teach Grotius several times, and Michael has gone so far as to write about him. I did have the good sense to take or sit in on most of the other courses Strauss offered while I was at Chicago. And those included a seminar on Hegel's philosophy of history, another course on Plato's Protagoras, a seminar on Montesquieu's spirit of the laws, a course on Plato's Meno, another course on Plato's apology of Socrates and Crito, along with selections from Xenophon's Memorabilia, a seminar on Nietzsche's Beyond Good and Evil and Genealogy of Morals, and another on Kant's political philosophy. As you can see from that list, which is in chronological order, Strauss used to alternate a course on an ancient with a course on a modern, or then a modern followed by an ancient. And if you added the last seminar he taught, which was on Aristotle's Politics, the list of courses I just gave would be representative of the spread of courses he taught for his whole time at the University of Chicago. The author he taught most frequently was Plato, but because he taught courses on different dialogues, the single work he taught most frequently was Aristotle's Politics. And the reason he gives in the Introduction to Political Philosophy is that is the place he thought the study of classical political philosophy should begin. Let me turn now to the transcript of his course entitled Introduction to Political Philosophy and talk briefly about the benefits to be derived from the remastered tapes. Now that I know that he's called the scalpel, I know what I'm dealing with. So I was given an assignment, and my assignment for this session was to go back and to look at what difference the remastering of the tapes had made on the original transcript. Now, there were not tapes to be remastered of all of the courses. There were tapes for lectures 1 through 5 and lectures 7 through 10. Then the remastering didn't reveal the kinds of lacuna that there were apparently in the Hobbes course. The largest omission in the original transcript was of a page-long account of Heidegger's suggestion that Western philosophy needed to come into conversation with Eastern philosophy. And having heard Professor Gravitch talk about this earlier, I now think that the slight differences between this particular statement and the one that's to be found in the existentialism lecture, as well as that's both in the Pengel edition and in interpretation, might be more significant than one might think. Most of the corrections made on the original transcript of this course, on the basis of the remastered tapes, involve single words, phrases, or word order. Comparing what the remastered tapes showed Strauss had actually said with the typed transcript, I concluded that the quality of the audio on the original transcript or tapes was very bad. It looked as if the transcriber was often trying to guess what Strauss had meant from the context. So far as I could tell, the changes in word order represented lapses in accuracy. It's not exact. But they did not change the meaning of sentences, although they could have. In many cases, the corrections of the original transcript on the basis of the remastered tapes resulted in the addition of words or phrases that seemed not to have been heard by the initial transcriber. Often these previously omitted words or phrases served to emphasize or slightly qualify what had been said. On the basis of the remastered tapes, the copy editor, Les Harris, who is here, reinserted terms like perhaps, very, and even. The most egregious omission of that kind I found was in Lecture 5, where the original transcriber had apparently not heard, and I quote, "And this is, I think, the crucial point." Strauss's point is in the transcript, but the emphasis on its importance is not. In some cases where the original transcriber apparently did not hear correctly, his or her guesses about what Strauss had said were not quite so innocent. Some of the changes or substitutions of the transcriber's sense for Strauss's own words introduced inaccuracies. For example, this is a kind of slight one. At the beginning of Lecture 2, Strauss states that Comte still calls the scientific study of society political philosophy, whereas the original transcript had him saying that Comte still calls scientific knowledge of society political philosophy. A little further down that page, the original transcript left the 18th century out of a list that should have been 16th, 17th, and 18th century philosophies. A few pages later, when Strauss says that according to Comte, the family is the school of sociability, the original transcript had social ability. Comte does say. Had it out for the family, because where in speaking about Comte on marriage, Strauss says that the changes conform to the invariable fundamental spirit of the institution, which alone here is our primary subject. The original transcript reads, and I quote, "which alone is clear our primary savagery." For example, when Strauss and some of the transcript, now you think those were funny. Okay, two more. So when Strauss speaks about something, quotes, "grasped by the meanest capacities," as Locke would say, "in a single sitting," the original transcript reads, "in a single city." And where Strauss adds an aside to his response to Arnold Brecht, "that is a dig," the original transcript read, "that is a pig." So You see, editing is better than you might think. More seriously, thinking about the fact that there were no tapes to remaster for half of the course I was editing, and no remaining tapes at all for many of the courses for which there are transcripts, I concluded that some of the errors that showed up as a result of the remastering could be caught by a careful editor of the original manuscript. For example, a careful editor could catch mistakes in the transcribing of foreign words or quotations, of which there were quite a few. Apparently, the original transcribers were not asked to look up the quotations or, I think, the texts that were being quoted. A careful editor could also catch and correct misheard or misidentified names on the basis of the thought attributed to the author in question. As, for example, in this transcript, when the original transcriber substituted Toynbee for Tawney and Weber for Hegel. So I think a copy editor would also probably see a problem in a transcript that characterized the proposition that men are created in the image of God as a biblical variation. Strauss had said biblical heritage. A copy editor would probably also see a problem with Strauss saying that captain in Italian is a military title. What Strauss had actually said in the context of discussing Comte's ideas about captains of industry and banking is that captain was originally a military title. But would an editor of the transcript of a lecture without a remastered tape catch an important omission in a thought attributed to a philosopher? As when Strauss reports that Schopenhauer thought that all thinking men agree on certain moral beliefs, but the original transcript says that he thought all men accept these beliefs, an empirically falsifiable proposition, I think. Even more troubling, would an editor of a transcript be able to recognize and correct the omission of a negative syllable or word, the omission of which completely changes the meaning of the sentence? As when the transcriber of these lectures did not hear and so dropped the un in front of bearable in a sentence describing conditions in the 19th century and omitted a don't in front of a praise in another sentence. In sum, my review of the changes made in the transcript of Strauss's introduction to political philosophy on the basis of the remastered tapes made me understand why the transcripts of his courses were originally circulated with a warning that they were uncorrected transcripts of oral material and should not be quoted. The remastered tapes have provided us with more accurate versions of some of his classes, but we do not have tapes to remaster for many of the transcripts. Editors will be able to correct many of the errors that were introduced in the process of transcribing the tapes, but I doubt that we will be able to catch and correct them all. I think, therefore, the transcript should be published with a disclaimer explaining that Strauss himself did not correct the transcripts. We should all nevertheless be grateful to Nathan Tarkoff for arranging for the tapes to be remastered and the transcripts of them eventually published, whether online or in print. I think for at least two reasons. First, and this has been very much stressed in this conference, Strauss's famous, or infamous in some circles, for having attracted a very large number of loyal students. The transcripts reveal some of the reasons why and how he did so. Readers of the transcripts will see that Strauss not merely tried whenever possible to find American examples to illustrate points for American students. He also encouraged students to ask questions, as you've heard, and he displayed a genial sense of humor. The transcripts note repeated instances of laughter. The second reason I at least think the publication of the transcripts will be valuable is that they contain analyses of authors and texts Strauss does not treat in his published writings. Because the transcripts are, of course, as he taught to students, his treatment of the philosophers in the transcripts is moreover often clearer and more direct than in his densely argued published works. So in the case of the course for which I edited the transcript, unlike most of Strauss's other courses and most of his published writings, the transcript of the Introduction to Political Philosophy does not present a detailed analysis of a particular text or texts. The lectures constitute a sustained argument designed to show not only why the study of political philosophy remains an essential endeavor, but also why the study of political philosophy in our time has to begin with the study of the history of political philosophy. As Abe Schulsky mentioned yesterday, Strauss began this course by criticizing two contemporary schools of thought, positivism and...
It feels like yesterday.
It wasn't yesterday? Oh, it's this morning. I'm sorry. Okay. Time flies, as they say, right? Okay. Positive and historicism. Similar critiques can be found in Natural Right and History, What is Political Philosophy, and an Epilogue. And in What is Political Philosophy, Strauss identifies Auguste Comte as the father of positivism. But in none of his published works does Strauss present, analyze, and criticize Comte's thought as he does in the first two lectures of his introduction. He does so in order to show that the positivist claim that only scientific knowledge deserves to be regarded as knowledge itself rests on a highly questionable account of the history of human thought. Unlike contemporary positivists, Strauss emphasizes, Comte did not think that the science of social dynamics, as he calls it, was or should be value-free. The problem with his positive philosophy was that it overestimated the power of reason. Contemporary positivists emphasize the limits of reason when they assert that we cannot know the ought, whereas we can have scientific knowledge of the is. Observing that neither of the philosophers, Hume and Kant, who introduced the is-ought distinction, thought that it was impossible to have knowledge of the ought, Strauss points out that the positivist assertion about the limits of our knowledge rests on a further assertion about the existence of multiple incommensurable ultimate values. And he finds that first in Georg Simmel and most developed in Max Weber. But he then argues that as a result of its prohibition of value judgments, positivism cannot answer the question, why science? Responding to two critics of his interpretation of Max Weber in Natural Right and History, Arnold Brecht and Ernst Nagel, Strauss next shows how and why positivism necessarily collapses into historicism. He then traces the development of historicism, beginning with Jean-Jacques Rousseau's contention that human nature is changeable. The rational and progressive character of human historical development could be established only after the process or change had come to its end. Strauss thus explains, as he does not in Natural Right and History, or in What is Political Philosophy, why Hegel thought the secularization of Christianity in the Declaration of the Universal Rights of Man during the French Revolution, and the subsequent institution of states in Europe explicitly based on those principles, had definitively answered the question that had previously animated political philosophy, namely, what is the best regime? Like the arguments of the previous philosophers, Strauss observes, Hegel's claim to have discovered the truth was subject to proof or disproof. Historicism proper was born when 19th century historians like Leopold von Ranke accepted the notion that every epoch has its own truth, but deny that history is rational or progressive, because they thought that history is an ongoing process that has no end in the sense of completion. The problem with this historicist contention, Strauss argues in a critique of the arguments of the British historian R.G. Collingwood, is that it contradicts itself by announcing a transhistorical truth, that all truth is historically delimited and defined. Strauss agrees with Collingwood, however, that philosophy now has to be fused with history in our search for self-knowledge. He argues, and I quote, every attempt at rational knowledge, philosophic or scientific, consists in replacing opinions by knowledge. This cannot be conscientiously done if one does not first know the opinions from which one starts. But what we regard as our opinions consist to a considerable extent of the sediments of past discussions. Hence, the non-historical concern with the clarification of our opinions insensibly shifts into historical studies. That's an argument he also makes in political philosophy and history. In contrast to Collingwood and the radical historicists, however, Strauss insists that we have to study the history of ideas, alert to the possibility that older thinkers knew things we have forgotten. To study the history of political philosophy, Strauss observes, we have to divide it into parts. Looking to find the division within the material itself, he finds the clearest break with previous thought in the works of Thomas Hobbes. Although Machiavelli announced the break earlier in chapter 15 of his Prince, Strauss concentrates on Hobbes because Hobbes formulates the modern position in terms of natural law, and Strauss emphasizes, and again I quote, the lowering of the standards has to do with a profoundly changed posture towards nature. Strauss then turns to Rousseau's critique of Hobbes because that critique brought modern political philosophy to its first crisis. But in another rather unusual move that highlights the importance of Kant in Strauss's reading of the history of political philosophy, Strauss explains both how and why Kant severed morality and reason from nature in an attempt to provide a rational foundation for both morality and science. Finally, Strauss makes the case for a reconsideration of the ancient alternative the moderns opposed by briefly tracing the extension of Kant's arguments by Fichte, Marx, and Nietzsche. In the last seven lectures in this course, Strauss then turns to what he calls the classical statement of the ancient position, and this is the position the moderns opposed in Aristotle's Politics. He explains why our study of classical political philosophy should begin with Aristotle much more clearly than he does in The City and Man by observing simply that Aristotle speaks in his own name, whereas Plato, the tragedians, and Thucydides, all of whom wrote earlier, did not. The reading of the Politics Strauss presents in these lectures is necessarily less detailed than that he gives in the three seminars he devoted solely to the Politics, and those transcripts will be available. In these lectures, Strauss emphasizes what he considers to be the chief points. The understanding of nature on the basis of which Aristotle famously declares that the polis is natural and criticizes Plato, the centrality of the question of regime, or who should rule, in Book 3, Aristotle's description of the best regime as the rule of gentlemen, in quotes, whose lives reflect, but only reflect, the true excellence or end of man in theoretical virtue, and Aristotle's analysis of the inferior but much more common regimes, especially democracy, in the light of the best. Strauss concludes these lectures by raising the issue with which he begins the chapter on Aristotle's Politics in The City and Man, by questioning the tenability of the distinction Aristotle, in contrast to Plato, drew between practical and theoretical knowledge. By comparing these lectures with Strauss's only published essay specifically devoted to the Politics, we see that these lectures are devoted to what Strauss says in concluding the chapter on Aristotle in The City and Man is, and I quote, the guiding question of Aristotle's Politics, the question of the best regime. But there, he says, is better discussed on another occasion. That occasion was apparently one of the few lecture courses he gave as an introduction to political philosophy to students at the University of Chicago. Soon, anyone who is interested will be able to see what Strauss thought about the guiding question of Aristotle's Politics, which he considered to be the primary work of classical political philosophy and the place students ought to begin their study of the history. Anyone who would like to listen can now hear the remastered tape. Thank you.
Thank you.
Despite all this talk of the scalpel that I've heard, his hand has been stayed for a few minutes, and he's given us a few extra minutes to discuss this. We have about 15 minutes for questions, and then we're going to have a changing of the guard for other questions. Yes.
My name is Hannes Kerber, and I would be very interested why Strauss, on your thoughts, why Strauss was so reluctant to get these lectures published, and also why he was so reluctant to not circulate them widely, and what his intention was of permitting the recording in the first place.
Whom is this directed to? Is it anyone on
you, Chris.
I'm going to duck that one.
I'll say something preliminary. At least the warning on the transcripts not to circulate them and quote them, I don't think came from Strauss himself. I believe that came from Joseph Cropsey and Herbert Storing, who were in charge of this project. So as far as I know and have been able to determine, Strauss allowed his lectures to be taped, but he didn't concern himself with doing anything but giving the lectures. His students did this.
Professor Gilding?
I was just going to say on this just a little more information that some of these transcripts weren't typed up until after he was dead. I mean, it's the Montesquieu course, I know the person who typed it was Joseph Bissett. And I think he was a graduate student here in at Chicago, and I think he came in 76 or 77. So there seems to have been a big distance between Strauss and the production or handling of the transcripts.
Professor Gilbert, was this on this point? Because I think a couple,
yeah.
Yes, go ahead.
Robert Hardwoods told me it was his idea. He asked Strauss. Strauss said, okay, if I don't have anything to do with it.
Okay. You can say,
it went on from there.
I think Professor Tarkoff and House have comments on this specific point.
One more point, although he was not willing to edit or check them, he was willing to sell them. He did sign a contract with Bantam Books for several of them to be published.
Thank you. Professor House?
This isn't exactly on this point, but it's a response to Mr. Sedeyn's remarks on, and I think that on the use by Strauss of the expression wisdom, and particularly the relationship between wisdom and logos that you talk about. In many respects, this is part of Strauss's debate with Kojève, and the idea of wisdom and the wise man is really an idea that was quite central to Kojève, and one that was challenged by Strauss in making the distinction between the philosopher and the wise man, to which Kojève eventually responded in the introduction to his history of pagan of philosophy. So I wouldn't want to depend, you know, largely or exclusively on those remarks in the Thucydides essay in unpacking the way in which Strauss thought about the idea of wisdom or sagesse. But I also just have one other comment. I actually am a translator myself, and I'm translating, among other works, Corinne Pelluchon's book on Strauss in English, which will be published by SUNY Press when I finish the translation, which is long delayed, but should be finished this summer. I mean, I am more optimistic about the situation with respect to familiarity with Strauss, not only in France, but in Europe. But for some reason, my own writings on Strauss are much better known in Europe. And I get a lot of email correspondence from quite young people, I mean, in their 20s, who have you know, read something and mm-hmm. and who you know are very new to this way of writing, but at the same time have one benefit, which is they do not come to Strauss with the set of prejudices that might be described as related to Straussianism, and this actually gives me a great deal of optimism, and also I think confirms Strauss's judgment in reserving perhaps his greatest energies for the writing of books which might actually be communications to generations of people who would not have directly or indirectly been his own students.
Well, I do agree with you. I also have emails from Arab countries, young students who seem interested. So I think we have, sure, and I think it is intrinsic to the quality of Strauss' work that it will find readers, but the question is, how many? So that's just a question, and we can't answer that question. Concerning the first, that's my conviction, that when Strauss speaks of Thucydides' wisdom, just like when Socrates speaks of human wisdom in Apology, it has nothing to see with to do with the controversy with Kojève. Absolutely not. And I think, but I dare to say it, that Strauss think really. I think that quotation which I made express the thought of Strauss deeply. Maybe I'm right, maybe not, but I do not think at all that he has to do with the controversy with Kojève. Really not.
Thank you. Alex Orwin?
I'd like to just say a word about the transcripts on Plato, since they weren't discussed, and I was given the job of editing a couple of them, Protagoras and Meno. I found them very, very useful. I don't think that any of Strauss's deepest thoughts on Plato can be found there, but nonetheless, he explains in the many of the more puzzling aspects of his interpretation to Plato in a very commonsensical way. You know, he explains the oaths, the different forms of address, the substitution of terms in a way which is very accessible and in no way sinister. And I think that in the future it will be a very good beginner's guide for reading Plato. I certainly think that I benefited a lot from studying the transcripts. If anyone wishes to test me on that, I did put Plato on my fundamentals exam. I'd be curious if anyone else would like to comment on the Plato transcripts, who has experience with them.
I think question could go to anyone who has had experience with the Plato transcripts.
Myself, I read the Gorgias and also the Protagoras, and I agree with you. They are very, very good introductions and readings of Plato's dialogue. That's true. It's very deep, and also the Gorgias is especially important because Strauss had the project of writing an essay on the Gorgias in his last book, but he didn't do. And we reading the the courses, we have an inkling of what he says, what his interpretation is, and it is very, very, very deep and coherent. So I agree, that would be very good introduction to read Plato.
I sense that we're ready for a break, and we'll try and re-adjourn quickly, about five minutes or less, maximum 5 minutes.